Okay, we will get started, folks. So the goal for today's class is to talk about solving problems of this type. Okay, so A is a matrix with lots of rows, A1 transpose, AR transpose. I think R is the number used in the book, yeah. AR transpose, B of course is comprised of scalar, lots of B. And so this is the problem that I'm faced with. And I know one algorithm that's really good, which is gradient projection algorithm. The gradient projection algorithm with unit step size, with alpha k equals to 1, is actually xk plus 1 equals to xk minus sk gradient of fxk plus, where plus denotes the projection. I need to project it back to the set of ax less than equal to b. Right? What did we talk about? So we had talked about, you know, projecting onto the set ax less than equal to b. Do you recall what the discussion was in that class? How easy is it to project onto the convex set ax less than equal to b? Very? Very easy. So we talked about projection onto sphere, projection onto a box set, projection onto a positive orthand, right? And we talked about projection on ax equal to b. So your assignment problem talks about projection on ax equal to b hyperplane. But for projecting onto ax less than equal to b, it's a very difficult problem. You have to run an optimization algorithm in order to do the projection. So the projection step is complicated. So projection is complicated. I don't want to use projection onto the entire space. So what are the ideas we could try? So let's look at the example, okay? Look at this figure. So I'm standing here, xk. This is my xk minus sk gradient fxk. And I need to project it onto this particular set. And I know that that is a very complicated affair. I don't want to do that. Can you think of some simplification by looking at that figure? Can we simplify the projection step? So let's remember. So projecting on AX equal to B is easy. It's just a matrix computation, matrix multiplication, but projecting onto AX less than equal to B is complicated. So I am here, I'm standing here, and I now have to go back into the set, and I have two options. Okay, option one, I do this complicated projection, which I hate to do. Okay, option two is instead of doing the projection onto this entire set, let me just do projection onto this particular hyperplane. Okay, because I know that projecting onto a hyperplane is much easier in comparison to projecting onto the entire AX less than equal to B convex set. So that's the idea of the manifold suboptimization method, which is I have a constraint set that is complicated to project on. So instead, I'm going to project onto a small subset of that particular set, convex set, which is just a set of active constraints at the moment. And that is going to simplify my projection problem. Of course, I have to take large number of steps, and there is always a trade-off between whether you want to do the projection or whether you want to take more number of steps with easier calculation at every point of time, right? And we have all talked about this trade-off, and this is a trade-off that you will have to make as optimizers in various industries and companies. So whether you want to do one iteration which is very accurate but takes 20 seconds to run, or whether you want to do 100 iterations, each of which takes 1 millisecond to run, that choice is yours to make. And definitely our goal would be to get to the solution as soon as possible. So this is the new idea. The idea is, instead of projecting onto the entire set, I'm just going to project it onto not one of the hyperplanes, but on the active set of active constraints. So let's understand what that algorithm is trying to do, okay? So in the previous lecture, we talked about the set of active constraints, A of X, which is the set of J, 1 to R, such that AJ transpose X equals to BJ. And let me call AK to be a matrix of AJ transpose, where J is in A of XK. So I stack all the active constraints, AJs. And I have to do BK as well. And the goal, the idea here, is find dk, the descent direction dk, such that ak dk equals to 0. Ak dk equals to 0. So we have a convex set, and we just want to restrict ourselves to projecting onto the set of active constraints where the descent direction must satisfy AK DK equals to 0. We will need it in some time. Yeah. Maybe BK itself may not be used, but all I want to say is I want to restrict, so I want to solve this problem for some time. I want to minimize fx such that akx equals to bk. For some time, I'm going to solve this problem. And then I have to figure out if I've reached a vertex. So I'm going along this direction, okay? And I'm moving, and now I have come to an end. And now I have to choose that I need to change my direction of descent, right? So how do you pick what's the new direction of descent is going to look like? So we'll get there in a bit, okay? But this is the subproblem we are trying to solve at every step of the game. And at some point of time, this AK and BK is going to change because I've come to a vertex, and I need to figure out in which direction should I go. So if you think of this room as a box, and I'm going along this particular edge, then there are two active constraints. One is this wall, and one is the floor, right? But when I get to that edge, I have three active constraints. One is going along this direction, one is going upwards, and one is going on this side. And so I have to pick. So I've been moving in that direction, so now I have two possible directions to go to, and I have to pick which of the two directions should I go to. So that's what we are going to focus on in today's class, about figuring out which direction should we be going at every step of the way. Okay, so there are two possibilities. One is I found a DK. Found DK which is not equal to zero. In which case I have a descent direction which is non-zero, so I'm going to start descending. I'll pick a step size and I'll descend. Second is DK equals to zero, in which case there are again two possibilities. Possibility A is we are at the optimal point, at the stationary point, or the option B is we are at a vertex. And need to pick a direction. Okay, so let's... So these are the three cases that we need to cover. Okay, so how do we compute DK? Okay, so we want to find DK which satisfies that constraint. So this is the subproblem I have to solve at iteration K. I want to minimize HK DK such that AK DK is equal to zero, and DK is in Rn. This is the subproblem I need to solve. Oh, actually DK is supposed to be a descent direction. So I'm going to remove the subscript here because I want it to be the solution to this problem. So this is dk would be argmin of this expression. So in typical example, you will take HK to be identity matrix, or you can take it to be the second derivative of the function or any other positive definite matrix. HK must be positive definite. Yeah, so the number of rows in AK is going to be much smaller than the number of rows of A, because you may not, all the active constraints may not be active. In your current assignment 3 problem 4, you have to implement this algorithm. It's going to take a lot of time, so I recommend you start early. And the reason is there are a lot of nuances with implementing optimization algorithms. That's why I want you to start early and go through all those nuances of implementing an optimization algorithm. So this AK will have a certain number of rows, and you want to make sure that AK times D is equal to 0. And this is the problem that you need to solve. And it turns out that actually you can solve this problem by hand. It's going to take a lot of effort, so we'll get to it maybe in end of October about how to solve it by hand. But this is the answer. So your dk, the optimal solution, is equal to minus hk inverse So I can actually compute my dk and mu k exactly. Well, dk exactly, and one of the intermediate variable is mu k. So I need this mu k in order to compute dk. Okay, mu k is a vector. This is a vector, and dk is also a vector, of course. So what happens when we find the descent direction? What's the next step? What do we do? Right, so now we need to figure out alpha k. So we have found the dk, and the next thing that we need to figure out is what value of alpha k should we pick. What do you suggest? How do we pick alpha k? So I now need to run. So let's assume that dk is not equal to 0. So I have the first if statement. If dk not equal to 0, pick alpha k. Let me say according to Armijo's rule. But you can use line minimization. You can use any of the other rules. Pick alpha k and proceed. But alpha k must satisfy some specific condition, which is we want a xk plus alpha k dk must be less than equal to B. So this is the condition that alpha k must satisfy. So you can't go outside the set. So I take such a long step, I'm walking, I take such a long step that I go outside the set. That's not acceptable. We must have alpha k such that A times xk plus alpha k dk is less than or equal to B. So you pick a value of alpha k, and if this constraint is violated, then you reduce the value of alpha k and then check whether this constraint is true or not. If all the constraints are met, you pick alpha k and then you proceed. If not, then you again reduce the value of alpha k and continue the process. Okay, so now we know how to, I mean, we have done picking of alpha k for so many codes that we know how to pick alpha k. We are fairly confident of that. But here is how you compute dk. Now, once you compute xk plus 1, what else do you have to do? Once you have figured out xk plus 1, then you also have to compute ak plus 1. So what are the set of active constraints? Are you at the edge or not? So you have to pick the set of active constraints ak, and then you have to rerun this algorithm, rerun this code to get the value of dk plus 1. So there is some intermediate step involved here as well to proceed. Now the second option is my dk is equal to 0. Now when dk is equal to 0, there are two options we will see. Option 1, option A, is mu k is greater than or equal to 0, and option B is mu k, there exists j bar such that mu k j bar is less than 0. Okay. So what I'm going to show you in a few minutes is if mu k is greater than or equal to 0, it means xk is stationary. So my dk is equal to 0, or my dk is, So when you are implementing, because you have to implement this algorithm, something you have to be careful about, when I write dk equals to 0, how should you code it in MATLAB? If norm of dk is less than 10 raised to minus 3, okay? So if norm of dk is less than 10 raised to minus 3 or minus 4 or minus 6, then you have to check two things. Is mu k greater than or equal to 0? In which case, xk is a stationary point and if f is convex, then you are at the optimal point and you can give that as answer. On the other hand, if there is an element of mu k such that mu k j bar is strictly less than 0, then drop j bar from the set of active constraints. And then proceed. Okay, yes, please.
What is J bar?
J bar, so this mu k is a vector. So in the vector, you will have like maybe 5 or 10 entries. So J bar is the entry in that vector which has a negative value. So there exists a J bar. So if mu k is, if all the elements of mu k is not non-negative, then there has to be an element which is negative, right? So that's what I'm trying to write here, that there exists an element in the vector mu k J bar, which is less than zero. So I want to drop that from the set of active constraints and continue my iterations. So there are a few things we need to understand here. The first thing is, if dk is non-zero, is it really a descent direction or not? So let's see why I'm saying that it's a descent direction. Can I erase this part? I think this is something all of you have written. So in a nutshell, this is the manifold suboptimization method. Okay, this is how you will write it in MATLAB. So you will have computation of dk, then one if loop if dk is not equal to zero. You will figure out how to compute alpha k and then proceed. If dk is equal to zero, you will have two more if conditions, and then you will proceed with your iterations. Okay, and whenever I write something is equal to zero, all it means is it has to be very, very small. And when I write this is less than equal to b, what happens if b minus, what you have to look at is b minus axk. Well, so one of the things that you will notice when you are running this iteration is you could have b minus axk plus alpha k dk. We want it to be greater than or equal to zero. Right, we want it to be greater than or equal to zero. And what you will notice is sometimes some of the values is like 10 raised to minus 6 or 10 raised to minus 5. Now, technically, it's not the set of active constraint because, you know, it's positive number, right? It's not active. But of course, we know that in MATLAB, we have to make sure that we check if this is less than 10 raised to minus 3, then it means it's an active constraint. Then that particular point is active. So no, bj and aj transpose. So if this is less than 10 raised to minus 3, then it's an active constraint. Then j is active. OK, so that's the only thing you need to check in this particular situation. It will become an active constraint as soon as the difference is very, very small within some tolerance. So when you are moving from the mathematical expressions to code, these are the things that you have to be worried about. So question one that I want to answer, if dk is not equal to zero, is it a descent direction? Let us try to answer this question. What does it mean for something to be a descent direction? Sorry?
It's going towards the minimum.
How do I check if it is going towards the minimum or not?
Xk plus 1 minus xk is less than.
Okay, let me write it the other way. That's what the meaning of descent direction is. If I take a small step, am I going to reduce the value of the function, which is what he was suggesting. But mathematically, this is what I want to check. So if dk satisfies this, then it means that it's a descent direction. How do I check whether, if dk is non-zero, this expression is satisfied? So let's look at this objective function and the constraint. So in the objective function, I have minimum of the inner product plus some quadratic term. And in the constraint, I have AK D equals to 0. So in particular, D equals to 0 satisfies the constraint, right? So D equals to 0 satisfies the constraint. And what happens here? What's the objective? The objective is equal to 0 when D is equal to 0. Now I'm doing minimization, okay? So if I'm doing minimization, it must be less than equal to 0. This expression must be less than equal to 0. So D equals to 0 is feasible, and gradient f of xk transpose 0 plus half 0 transpose hk 0 is equal to 0. Now dk is the optimal, then it must be the case that gradient of fxk transpose dk is less than or equal to 0. Okay, so t equals to 0 is feasible, and at that point the objective function has 0 value, but I'm actually minimizing. So at the optimal point dk, the objective function must have a value less than or equal to 0, which is non-optimal value. So if this holds, then it means gradient of fxk transpose dk is less than or equal to minus half dk transpose hk dk, which is strictly less than 0 because hk is positive definite and dk is non-zero by assumption. So gradient of fxk transpose dk is dk is a descent direction because the inner product with the gradient is strictly less than 0. So question 1 is answered. This is correct. Okay. Any questions so far? All of you convinced that if dk is non-zero, it must be a descent direction because, in other words, it must have an inner product with the gradient less than 0, and the proof is right here in front of you of that statement. Now the second question is, if dk is equal to 0 and mu k is non-negative, so all the elements of mu k vector is non-negative, am I at the stationary point? So let's answer the second question. Any question on this before I erase it? Okay. Question 2. If dk is equal to 0 and mu k is greater than 0, is xk stationary? What does it mean for xk to be stationary in this context? We want gradient of fxk transpose x minus xk is greater than or equal to 0 for all x such that AX is less than equal to B. Okay. So this is what I need to prove now, and it seems pretty difficult, but let's try to see what happens. So let's try to answer this question. This is the question mark here. So I have my dk to be minus hk inverse gradient of ek fxk plus ak transpose mu k, and by hypothesis dk is equal to 0. What does this mean? So if my dk is equal to 0, I have negative hk inverse, and then I have some one vector plus another vector. When can this be equal to 0? Well, when this term is actually equal to 0. The sum of two vectors is equal to 0. And what that implies is gradient of fxk is summation mu kj aj, j is the set of active constraints. Absolutely. There should be a minus sign. Okay. Now, what are the set of feasible directions at xk? In order to prove that I satisfy this condition, I need to multiply it with the set of all feasible directions and show that it is non-negative. So what's the set of all feasible directions, D? It's so AK XK equals to BK. So this means that the set of all feasible directions would satisfy AK times D is less than equal to 0. Or in other words, AJ transpose D is less than equal to 0 for all J in the set of active constraints. So let's go back to this particular expression. So I am standing at a point where AK XK is equal to BK. It's the set of all active constraints. In the other dimension where, you know, for other rows, my direction could either increase the value of AJ transpose XK or it could decrease the value, I don't care. But on this active constraint, the only thing I can do is such that AK times D is less than equal to 0, because I have a constraint that AX is less than equal to B. This is the constraint I'm under. So no matter which direction I pick, my AX has to be less than equal to B. So the set of all feasible directions satisfy AJ transpose D less than equal to 0 for all J in the set of active constraints at XK. That's the set of all feasible directions. Now, let's multiply the gradient of FXK transpose the set of all feasible direction, or whatever, any feasible direction. So I have negative summation J in the set of active constraints mu kj aj transpose d. This is non-negative. This is less than equal to 0 for all feasible directions d from here. Okay, so I have gradient of FXK transpose D, where D is any feasible direction, turns out to have this summation structure where one of the term is non-negative by hypothesis, mu k is greater than or equal to 0. The other term is negative because D is a feasible direction. So I'm multiplying a positive or non-negative term with a non-positive term. I get a non-negative term, non-positive term. I have a minus sign in front. So this must be greater than or equal to 0, which means I am at the stationary point. My xk is a stationary point. This x is all x such that ax is less than or equal to b. Right? So let me show you a picture.
This in a loop, x of k will be the current point.
The current point.
And then x is?
X is everything else. So I'm standing at x of k, and I have like the set of feasible directions that I can go to. So what I have done here is characterize the set of all feasible directions. Okay? And so x minus xk is basically this d, which is the set of all feasible directions that I can take standing at xk. And what we have established is gradient of f transpose all feasible direction is non-negative, which means that xk is stationary. This is the first order necessary condition of optimality for optimization over convex set. Okay.
And this is D.
This D is the this D here.
I mean, this D is not DK. This is while you're.
Oh, this D is X minus XK. This D is X minus XK. That's the set of all feasible directions, right? Okay, and then the corresponding third question was, if dk is 0 and one of the elements of mu k is negative, then if you drop the negative, like the constraint corresponding to the negative value of mu k, would you get a descent direction? And that answer is also yes. So let me write down the expression. I won't prove it because the proof is fairly long for that part. But I'll write down what exactly is the third question for which the proof is in the book. So I'll let you read it from the book directly if you're interested. So the third question is, my dk is equal to 0 and there exists a j bar such that mu k j bar is less than 0. So the j barth component of mu k is less than 0. Let ak tilde be defined as A J transpose J in AXK minus J bar. So I remove the J bar from the set of active constraint. And in MATLAB, the way to get this thing done is, so MATLAB. Let me remember. I want to remove the jth row, j barth row from the. Ak j bar row all columns is equal to an empty matrix. So if you if in MATLAB you set AK J bar comma colon to be equal to an empty matrix, it will remove that row from the matrix. Okay, that's the MATLAB notation. I'm sure there would be some corresponding Python notation as well. I'm just not aware of it. So this is what you would do in MATLAB to remove the jth row, J barth row from the set of active constraints. Okay, all of you have noted this command. I see some people writing, so I'll wait. Okay. So I've removed the J barth row from the matrix AK. I get A tilde K. And then I recompute D tilde K. I just have to change this AK to A tilde K and then recompute D tilde K. Then gradient FXK transpose D tilde K is less than 0. So D tilde K is a descent direction. If I remove the constraint corresponding to the negative value of mu K, negative component of QK, then I will proceed in a descent direction. Okay. Now we have seen all the mumbo jumbo. Let's try to understand what's happening through a picture. And let me draw a three-dimensional diagram. And you are doing this optimization over this loaf of bread. And you start from some point on the surface. You could start from anywhere. You could start from interior, you could start from the surface, but the point has to be within the set. It can't be outside the set. So you start from a point within the set, and you have some set of active constraints. So you are doing gradient descent on moving exactly within the set of active constraints, okay? You're not going outside, you're not going above, you're not going below, you are just being on that particular hyperplane. Then you come to a point where there are two active constraints, and so you have to continue moving along the active constraint direction. So you go like this. So here the number of active constraint is 1. When you reach this point, the number of active constraints become 2, and then you are descending along the descent direction, and then you reach a point where the number of active constraints is 3 in a three-dimensional space. So this is the case where AK, where DK becomes equal to 0. There is no feasible direction to go to because all three constraints are active. And now you need to figure out whether to take this path or you need to take this path. And so you look at which is the constraint where mu k j bar is less than 0. So let's assume that this is the j bar such that mu k j bar is less than 0. Less than 0. So then you are descending along this direction. Then again you come here where three constraints are active. And so you need to again remove one of the set of active constraints and you figure out, okay, this is the descent direction. And then at some point of time you realize that, okay, you need to now move inside. So you move inside. And then again, you will get to some optimal point, xk, at which your dk is equal to 0 and mu k is all non-negative. And at that point, you will terminate and you will say, okay, I'm at a stationary point. There's nothing much I can do. And if your function f is convex, you're at the optimal point. If your function f is not convex, hard luck. You are just left with a stationary point and you have to deal with the disappointment. So that's how the manifold suboptimization method works. If you were running the gradient projection method, at every point of time you take a step and then you project it onto this whole space, I mean or the whole subset, which is a complicated affair. You don't want to do that. It's going to take 10 seconds to do the projection. So you restrict yourself to the set of active constraints, in which case the projection is merely some matrix multiplication, some matrix inverse, all of which is easy to do. And then you proceed in this direction, in this way. So you're taking a much larger number of steps, as you can see. If you were running a gradient projection method, you wouldn't have to take so many steps. You would have done the whole thing in maybe 5 or 10 steps. But because you are restricting yourself to be following the set of active constraints at all time, you don't have that luxury. You have to take much larger number of steps. But hey, every step is a very fast calculation. So, you know, it's a trade-off that you have to make. Any question on this algorithm? So this is one of the first algorithms for solving linear programming problem developed around World War II. In the context of linear programming, it's called simplex algorithm, and there is some fast implementation of simplex algorithms on computers, and it works beautifully well on many linear programming problems. Okay, but this manifold suboptimization works for any nonlinear function. You don't have to have a linear objective function. You can have a nonlinear function and you can still use this. I'm not quite sure whether it was useful for actual deployment in World War II or not, but that was the motivation, to deploy resources across the country, and what's the minimum cost of transportation to pay to move, I don't know, grains and ammunitions and whatever from one place to another. in the country. So this was developed in 1940s, and it's still one of the best algorithms out there. But there are two other algorithms for linear programming problems that I'm going to cover. The one is affine scaling method, which was developed in late 1970s, and that will be covered in the next class. The idea in that class is, instead of being on the surface and the edges, you are actually going to go in the interior of the set, and you will get to the optimal point through the interior. So you will never be at the surface at all. So that's affine scaling method. And then the other one is interior point method, which we will talk about maybe like 10 classes later, which is also going through the interior of the set and converges to the optimal point. And the interior point method has the best theoretical bound for complexity. So it converges very fast. But in practice, simplex method and interior point method, both of them work beautifully. So that's all I have for today. I'll see you guys on Friday. Thank you.